Hey, thanks again for coming. If you want to find out more about just different tools and things that we have, leadyourfamily.org, there's blogs, and we do these things called six-minute videos. I'm a preacher, so most six-minute videos go about 9-10 minutes. So, but everything, there's a lot of stuff there. Then also growmore.org, there's a lot of leadership stuff. There's videos and blogs, and we have a parent pack. We have all kinds of stuff. And so if you want to check out those, you can make yourself available to those, growmore.org and leadyourfamily.org. Let's pray, and we'll get to it today. Lord, thank you for this morning. Thank you for safety. Thank you for your peace. And God, we just ask today that you would help us to just focus in. We're here today for a purpose. We're here today for a reason, and that is to sharpen ourselves so that we can be the husbands and the wives that we need to be and that we want to be. We can be the parents of our children that they need us to be and that we want to be. So God, guide my voice today, guide our heart today. Help us to zone in and focus in these next few moments. In Jesus' name, amen. What time do I need to be done?
About
30 minutes. Great. All right, here we go. So we're going to get to work here. Okay. Jesus talked in parables a lot. And as you all know, and one of the, Jesus would say, like, the kingdom of heaven is like a man on a journey. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. The kingdom of heaven is like. And he was always talking in word pictures. This was before Instagram and Facebook and social media that you could, show the memes and all that stuff. So he was always painting word pictures for people. And looking at the family, I see everything in pictures. And looking at the family, I see the family as a tree. Your family, my family, every family is like a tree. And I'm going to turn this the other way here. When it comes to a tree, we all want to have certain fruit that is bore from our tree. So just like a tree, this isn't a piece of broccoli. It's going to look more like a piece of broccoli, I think, sometimes. But when it comes to a tree, we all want to have fruit on our tree. I have a lemon tree at our house. I didn't realize it had lemons on it. I was trimming it like it was a bush, and then all of a sudden lemons started popping up. Like, whoa, this is cool. So we have a lemon tree. And when it comes to our family, we all have certain fruit that we want to bear from our family. I don't think anybody wakes up in the morning saying, I want to have bad fruit. We all want good fruit. So what do we want? We want to bear love. We want to have memories. We want to have moments. We want to have laughter. We probably want to have hobbies. We want our family to be financially taken care of. We want to have peace. We want to have a family that we want to actually come home to every night. That's what we want. I mean, we want to have a family, man, 5 p.m. or 6 p.m., 7 p.m., whatever time you get off of work, you can't wait to get in the car and head home. That's what you want. You want a family that bears love, joy, peace, laughter, moments, memories, hobbies, financially taken care of. You can pay your bills. That's what you want from your family, okay? Now, when it comes to, like, any tree that's going to bear good fruit, your family has to be a healthy tree. See, it looks more like a piece of broccoli there. I need to get this thing bigger. So when it comes to your family is like a tree. And you want to bear good fruit, but any tree that bears good fruit has to have what? Strong roots, not just roots. Everything's got roots. Every tree has roots, but only a tree with good roots bears good fruit. So you have to have your roots. I have to have my roots as an individual, because we don't have time to get into it. But as a parent, you are going to teach what you know, but you will reproduce who you are. I can read all the books and go to all the conferences and do what you're doing this weekend, and you go home and you can tell your kids, hey, here's what Pastor Kevin said, or here's what so-and-so says. That's awesome. But you know what they're going to be like? They're going to be like who you are. I look more and more like my dad every day. I don't really care for it, but it happens, okay? I laugh like my dad. I sound like my dad. There's been so many times that my kids will say, oh, my gosh, that's Grandpa Moore. And I'm like, oh, come on, kids, you're kidding. Like, oh, God, that's my dad, you know? So you are going to, this has to be you. What I'm drawing today can't be, oh, that's got to be my girl. My wife's got to change. Or my husband's got to change. I wish my kids would change. We'll do this as a whole family. No, you'll do it as a whole family when you do it as an individual. So, again, we don't have time to get into all that. But you, first of all, you have to have your roots grounded in the right thing. And the thing that you need to be rooted in, the Apostle Paul was writing to the church in Colossae, and this is what he says in Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 10. And man, this has quickly become one of my life verses. He says this. Says that as you therefore have received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding in it with thanksgiving. Beware lest anyone cheat you through the philosophy and empty deceit according to the traditions of men, according to the basic principles of the world and not according to Christ. For in him, in Christ, dwells the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, who is the head and the principalities and powers. Scripture says there that you as an individual person, that as you have come to Jesus Christ, that you now should be rooted in and grounded in Christ. And when you get rooted and grounded in Christ, it says you will be firmly established. You're not going to be wavering like the waves of the sea and going back and forth. You're going to be rooted and strong. It says you'll be established and you will be built up. There'll be something that will spring up out of you. You'll be built up in Christ. So you need to be rooted in Christ. Now, how do we get rooted in Christ? That sounds good. Sounds churchy. Hallelujah. Let's dig our roots down in Jesus. That sounds great. How do you do that, though? I know it's early. You guys aren't ready for the preach yet, so we'll hold that for the next a little bit later. How do you do this? Scripture says that faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. That's a perpetual hearing and hearing and hearing and hearing. That's what he says there. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God. So you get rooted in Christ primarily by reading and applying God's Word. Now, what happens in the typical Christian life is we have one root coming down out of our life called the morning, the Sunday weekend gathering. Yeah. And you're going to come and you're going to hear the Word of God on Sunday morning. Your teacher's going to teach it. Your pastor's going to preach it. And that's good and great. So you're hearing the Word here. And then if you're really, you are really following Jesus, you're coming to midweek, getting involved in a small group. So you've got two roots. Weekend, midweek. Weekend, midweek. That's awesome. However, how much fruit does a two-rooted tree bear? How strong is a two-rooted tree? How tall is a two-rooted? Not very much on any count. You show me a tree with two roots, and I'll show you a tree that doesn't have hardly any fruit on it. If you want to have a family that can withstand the winds and the storms of life, that can go through the different seasons like y'all do here in Indiana, winter, spring, summer, fall, California, we got two. It's called hot and then a little bit of rain. That's it. That's what we got. But if you want a family that's going to withstand all of the seasons of life like a healthy tree, you got to have more than two roots. You got to get your weekend, that's fine, but then you got to go to church on Sundays, you got to go to church on Wednesdays, and then you hear the Word of God through reading it, you hear the Word of God through hearing yourself, you hear the Word of God by memorizing it, you hear the Word of God by listening to a podcast, you hear the Word of God by listening to your pastor's message again, you hear the Word of God by reading it, and meditating, and just seeping into God's Word. And when you get into God's Word, you get into Jesus, because Jesus is God's Word. Amen. Scripture says that the Word became flesh and he dwelt among us. Some people always say, the Bible, Jesus never talked about this. That's Old Testament. Jesus is the Old Testament. Okay, so the more you get into God's Word, the more you get into Jesus. The more you get into Jesus, the more you have everything that you need. Now, the problem is we tend to not be rooted in Christ. We tend to get duped into what Paul said to be careful to do. Don't fall into the trappings and the philosophies of this world. The world will tell you your strength comes from your career. Your strength comes from your calling. Your strength comes from your family. Your strength comes from your kids. What happens when your kids move then? What happens when you lose your job? There's no strength there. There's not much nutrients there. We need to be, don't be duped and be rooted in something other than Christ. What happens many times is we take things that should be a fruit and we make that our root. Fruit, money should be is a fruit of a strong Christian life. It's a horrible fruit. Hobbies are a great fruit out of a healthy family. Moments and memories, and those are things that are fruits. They are not roots. Now, I don't know if you got a notebook or not, but if you do, write this down, because this is gold. It'll help you. It might be the only thing you remember this whole week. It's this. When you make a fruit your root, your life won't be worth a hoot. Hello. When you make a fruit your root, your life won't be worth a hoot. You've got to be rooted in Christ. Here's the thing. You don't have to be. But if you want this, you have to be. Okay, you don't have to be. There's a lot of options in life. But if you want a good family tree, you got to be rooted and grounded in Christ. That's number one. Number two is you have to build the tree trunk of trust. Build the tree trunk of trust. Now, we live in a society that says this. We live in a society that says, if you will, I will. If you will, I will. If you give me a reason to trust you, then I'll trust you. If you will be honest, then I'll be honest. If you'll be kind, then I'll be kind. If you help me, I'll help you. Listen, how does the old saying go? You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. That's you. It starts with you. Hey, you help me, I'll help you. That is not how God's kingdom works. The kingdom of God is not you help me, I help you. The kingdom of God, Jesus said in the book of Luke, he said, give and it shall be given back to you. It doesn't start with them, it starts with me. Whatever I give, I will get. Now, many times we use Luke chapter 6 when it comes to finances. You write a check, you'll get a check. You give $5, you'll get $5. And yes, that's true. However, the true contextual content of that passage is not talking about finances solely. It's actually talking about everything, number one, but then also everything within the personal relationships. So, but in that, he says, give and it. Whatever it is you give, you will get back. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give back to you. So here's the thing. If you want to get a trustworthy relationship from your spouse, what should you then first give your spouse? Trustworthiness. If you want to receive a trusting relationship from your children, that you know that they are honest, they are wholesome, if they've said it, they mean it. If you want to trust them, what do you first have to give them? Trustworthiness. Because if you are honest, you will receive honesty. If you are trustworthy, you will receive trustworthiness. I call it the boomerang principle. I actually went out and bought a little cheap little boomerang to help me remember this. I've never thrown it yet. It's going to be fun for me. Somebody's probably going to get killed up in here, but that's okay. Is a boomerang, I've heard anyway, when you throw it, which actually you throw it overhand, but when you throw a boomerang, when you throw it, it comes right back. That's Luke 6. It's the boomerang principle. So you need to, number one, be rooted and grounded in Christ, and when you're rooted and grounded in Christ, you become more honest, more kind, more authentic, more trusting. And as you live that to your family, they will begin to live that to you. So, rooted in Christ, build the tree trunk of trust, and then there's three main branches that bear fruit in your family. The first one is you spend your time. Spend your time. Now, we talked at length about this on Friday, but you spend your time. And when it comes to time, the thing that we've got to understand is that Scripture says in Psalms chapter 39, verse 4, it says, Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. You have made me no longer than the width of my hand. My entire lifetime is just a moment to you. At best, each of us is just a breath. Our most valuable commodity is time. Time. You see, a lot of people have the misconception that the greatest, here's the thing. If we ever ask ourselves, what is the outside of the person and the work and the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross, what is the greatest gift that God has ever given us? Some would say, well, it would be my family, it would be God's word, it would be time around Christian believers. However, I feel like, and I might be wrong, but I've got the mic, so who knows, is the greatest gift outside of the person and the work of Jesus Christ that God has given us is time. Because we spend time in God's word. We spend time with our family. We spend time with Christian believers. We spend time to go to the store and spend our money. Time is, it's the thing that God has given. It's the currency that God has given us to use to enjoy all the other gifts that he's given us. Once we spend time, it's the only thing that we have that once it's spent, we can never get it back. And so when it comes to your family, we need to give our most prized possession, which is our time, to our kids. And as we are grounded in Christ, we give trust, we spend time, because our family spells time, M-O-N-E-Y, and our family spells time, L-O-V-E, love and money and moments. Moments. Spend your time with your family. We're really going to break that down a lot more in the next session. The second one is you have to set godly boundaries. So grounded in Christ, give trust, spend time, and set godly boundaries. Now here's the deal. Who here in the room is a parent? Raise your hand if you're a parent. Okay. All of you, for the most part. Now, here's the deal. You parents, and even spouses, we have to grab a hold of this because we say that we know it, but many times we don't live this way. Rules and boundaries are good. Rules and boundaries are good. And a lot of times we say, no, they're not, because the rules and boundaries that I've set have caused tension in my life. The rules haven't caused the tension in your life. It's the heart in which those rules are being disobeyed that have caused the tension in your life. Rules are good, and we live in a culture that is so degrading to rules and to boundaries and to authority. Rules are good. Here's a couple things that rules do, boundaries do. Number one, rules help you play the game. I played basketball. I'm from Indiana. I played basketball. You know, the typical story. I'd have been a D1 player, but I hurt my knee. You know how that goes. But so, not really. In high school, I was like this height, 6'1", 160 pounds, and I was a power forward. There's not much need at Indiana University for 6'1", 160 power forward. So it ain't going to happen. But anyway, that's the lie I keep telling myself. I love basketball. But the problem is I hated playing basketball in gym class. You know why? Because when we played basketball in gym class, nobody played by the dad-blame rules. Excuse the French there, but it still makes me upset. They didn't play basketball. This cat, he's a wrestler, and I'm trying to post up. This son of a gun gets me down in some chokehold and is wrestling me right on the court, and the coach don't even call a foul. One guy gets the basketball, doesn't dribble. He just gets the basketball, takes off running. I'm like, what are we playing here? We're not playing football and rugby and wrestling. We're playing basketball. In basketball, you have to catch the ball. You can pivot, but you can't do this with the ball. That's dancing. We're not dancing. We're playing basketball. But the guys didn't play by the rules. And because they didn't play by the rules, we're not playing basketball. Life, you can only play life when you play life by life's rules. And many people in our culture today wonder why their life is so confusing. It's so out of whack. It's because they're not playing life. They're playing by a completely different set of rules. God sets the boundaries. And so because of that, we have to understand that, number one, rules, they help our family play family. Okay, we're in America, we're not getting the results of family because we're not playing family. We're playing something else. So we got to figure out what's godly boundaries and set them. Second thing that rules do is they protect. Like I said on Friday, you put a fence up, it's going to protect my children from the coyotes on the outside. It's going to protect my children from walking out into the streets. It's going to protect my dog from getting out in the road. A fence helps people enjoy what is in and helps people stay, the bad stay out. So set up a fence. It protects. But the third one is this is many times what we forget about boundaries and rules. Rules, they provide us opportunity to play the game. They protect us. But then the third things that rules will do for your family, godly rules will do, is they actually propel you forward. Rules propel you forward. When you think about water, what is it that makes a water a rushing river that moves forward? It's not the slope of the land. It's what? It's the banks. It's going down, and that's part of it. Yeah, but if you take the banks of the river away, all you have is you have a marsh. Yeah. You have stagnant, stale water. It's a bank here and a bank here that moves the pressure of the water forward. It's the banks. That's the rules. And things in your family, we are going to go to church every single Sunday, even when it's a blizzard outside, like y'all are obeying this rule. But is you're going to go to church. What happens is they come to church and they learn things at church, and that propels them forward. They're not going to get things at home or Buffalo Wild Wings that they're going to get at church. So we set a standard. We're going to go to church. When you set a standard, we're going to do our studies. We're going to do this. We're not going to do that. Those boundaries, they actually propel you forward towards the things that God has. So that's, you got to understand three things about boundaries. And here's the fourth thing about boundaries. Parents, raise your hand again. Okay. Keep your hand up. In your house, the one with your hand up right now, you're the one who sets the rules. Okay? You are the CEO. You have the corner office. You have the corner office. And when you're not in the corner office, the whole company's off kilter. So the best way I can describe this is this. I like to fly. I flew here. I'm getting ready to fly. Going to go to Dayton and then fly home. And hopefully it's all going to be on track. We'll see what happens. But I like to fly. Now, whenever I fly, some things happen. As I get on a plane. Now, when I get on a plane, one of the things I typically do, Pastor, is I walk in and I say hi to the stewardess or the steward. And then I always take a look into the cockpit to make sure that there's a pilot in there, okay? I just always do, just to make sure that daddy's in there, mama's in there, we're okay. I just want to make sure. So I just take a quick little look, and then off I go. Now, I go as a passenger who's paid for my ticket. I go and I find my seat, and the steward serves me, and the pilot, she's piloting the plane, or he's piloting the plane. Now, in that scenario, the pilot is piloting the plane, and the pilot is talking to the tower. The tower gives the pilot instructions on when to pull out, when to take off. If there's turbulence, the pilot talks to the tower, and they say, you need to go a little higher, you need to go out, you need to go down. But the pilot talks to the tower when there's turbulence, and the tower and the pilot figure out where we're going to take the plane. Now, after conversing with the tower, me as a passenger, I will hear the pilot say, ladies and gentlemen, just want to let you know that we have talked to the tower. There's going to be turbulence for about the next 30 minutes. So ding, ding, the seatbelt seats will be on. And all of a sudden you hear it, ding, ding, the seatbelt seat goes on. Please remain seated. And stewardesses and stewards, please take your seat until further notice. Thank you for flying United. The guy takes us wherever he needs to go. Ladies and gentlemen, turbulence is over. Now you can move about the plane. And then we're good to go, and then we land. That's how it's supposed to go. Yeah. Now, I'll just be straight up honest with you. I don't want to be on a plane that doesn't work that way. Yeah. I don't want to be on a plane as a passenger. If I'm on a plane and all of a sudden we're hitting some turbulence, and all of a sudden I see the cockpit door open, and the pilot comes out and says, hey, ladies and gentlemen, I just wanted to let you know we're hitting some turbulence right now. It's going to be rough for the next few moments. Who here thinks we should go up to 35,000 feet? Raise your hand. Who here thinks we should go down to 25,000? Oh, who here thinks we should just turn the plane around? Okay, oh, thank you very much. I think we're going to go ahead and go to 35,000 feet. Okay, and then I wouldn't want to be in that plane. I also don't want to be on a plane when all of a sudden the pilot comes out and says, hey, you know what, I'm really confused and I don't know what to do. And passenger in seat 36A says, I know what to do, scooch over. And she goes up and sits in the pilot seat, and now she's flying the plane. I don't want to be in that one either. Why? Somebody's going to die. But unfortunately, that's how many families, many parents run their family. You are the pilot of, and your family's in the plane. Your 12-year-old is a passenger on your plane. So you sit in the cockpit and you talk to the tower God and you figure out where you're going to fly and how you're going to fly the plane, and then you just inform the kids. You don't ask your kids if they want a cell phone. You don't ask your kids if they want blocks on a cell phone. Ladies and gentlemen, just want to let you know that we are not going to have a cell phone until you're 16 years old. Thank you very much. Have a seat. You don't say, what's your friend's doing? What's your company? You don't ask them. You ask God. God tells you. You tell them. That's the rule. You set the boundaries. And many times we don't play the family game that we want to play because we don't have the boundaries of family. Many times we have wolves in our family, we have temptations in our family, we have struggles in our family because we've lifted up the walls of boundaries and let all manner of wickedness come right into our home. We don't have, we're not moving forward in our family, we're not in that airplane going forward to our destination because we are not dealing with the tower, we're dealing with our children and letting them and us figure out how to set the rules. I don't trust myself with anything. I don't trust myself with anything. Nobody lies to me like I do. No, you know why I weigh what I weigh? It's because I keep telling myself, the buffet bar ain't that bad. No, it's bad. I shouldn't eat at the buffet bar, but I keep telling myself I'll start tomorrow. No, I won't. I lie to myself all the time. I'm so confused. I'm so confused I can't even get up at the right alarm clock. I can't find my phone half the time. And I think I can figure out how to run my family? I can't. You can't. That's what the tower's for. So we get rooted in Christ. We begin to give trust. Don't wait on trust. Start giving it. Even now when you can't trust them, make them trust you. You'll get it back eventually. You spend time. You set boundaries. And then the last one is you walk in forgiveness. Dylan, where am I at on time, buddy? I don't even know. 5 minutes, okay. So the last one is you walk in forgiveness. Now, when it comes to forgiveness, I think there's a few principles to remember, a few principles to live by as well. Is this is a tough one. Is again, I want to talk about two things just real quick. Is on the forgiveness side, you get what you give. So if you want, here's the thing with our families. You know as well as I do, your spouse and your kids are not going to be perfect. So what you're wanting is not a perfect life to where you don't have to forgive. What you're wanting is an honest opportunity to forgive. And by that I mean is when your kids mess up, you want to have a house that your kids trust you enough to come to you and say, you're right, I dropped the ball. And when they mess up, they come to you and they ask for forgiveness. That's what you want from your spouse. That's what you want from your kids. The tension isn't necessarily that they did something wrong. It's that they did something wrong and they hid it and it kept going deeper and deeper. You want a house that people actually just feel free to know everybody's kind of broken. I'm going to make mistakes and I dropped the ball. I love you enough to let you know. Can we talk this through? Sure. How do you get that type of house? Is you become that first. So as a parent, if you raise your voice when you shouldn't, you very quickly come back to your child, step out of pride and say, Daddy raised his voice. Will you forgive me? Yeah. If you drop the ball with your spouse, man, you know what? I know you was wanting me home by 5. I rolled in at 5:30, and you could tell she's a little tense about it. Don't bow up a little bit and say, woman, I've been working all day. What are you thinking? What? No, no, no. You know what, honey? You're right. Yeah. I said 5 o'clock, and baby, I'm sorry. Right. Now, what are you going to get? You're going to get what you gave. So if you want a home that quickly says, I'm sorry, then you need to be that first. That's the first one. The second one is when to truly walk in forgiveness, to truly walk in forgiveness and have complete reconciliation, okay? Forgiveness has to be asked for. And that's something that I can say I forgive you. And now I'm free from it. But for our relationship to be reunited, and now we are walking in true relationship, they have to have a change of heart and say, I'm sorry as well. And this is like a session all on its own on how to walk in forgiveness. But I just want to give you just real quick a couple tips when it comes to walking in forgiveness. Is here number one, in order to walk in forgiveness, is you have to, number one, you have to confront the offense. You got to, we're going to talk more about this in the message, but you, when it comes to fixing something, you got to confront the offense. You can't ignore it. You can't say it's just a season. No, a ball was dropped. Confront it. Confront the offense, number one. Number two is you have to have a conversation, not a yelling match, a harsh answer stirs up anger. It's a soft word that turns away wrath. So you need to have a conversation, so you confront it. You have a conversation that gets you to the truth. And then next is you deal in complete honesty. You've got to dig down and get to honesty. Because human nature, we want to, self-preservation kicks in, and your kids begin to realize, if I tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God. It might hurt my butt. I might get grounded. I might lose my phone. So they're going to tell you just enough to smooth it over, but not get all the way down. You got to love them enough to get all the way down. Get to the truth. Deal. Complete honesty. And then lastly is you need to contemplate the best result. What's the best way to protect? What's the best way to propel us forward? Sometimes there's no punishment at all. Sometimes there's no punishment at all. Other times is a timeout. Sometimes there's a grounding. Sometimes there's a spanking. Sometimes it's tough love. I'm not going to give you that money. No, you can't go there. Sometimes when they get a little older, time to move on out the house. Well, I thought you said we're walking in forgiveness. I mean, sure, he's 26 years old, been living in the basement since he was 18, does nothing but play video games, doesn't want to get a job, but he said he was sorry. That's a whole other thing. No. At some point, there has to be a reconciliation. Yeah. You say, well, I thought this was forgiveness. It is forgiveness. That's how God forgave you. Yeah. In forgiveness, again, this is such a longer session. In forgiveness, somebody's taking it on the chin. Yeah. Sin has to be punished. Someone's taking it on the sin. On the chin. Where you say, well, I got forgiven of my sins. Why? Because God crushed Jesus. Yeah. Right. God said, I will forgive you, so I'm going to crush my son. And when you come to me and say, I'm sorry, forgiveness is yours. But if God crushes his son and we don't say we're sorry, forgiveness is not ours. So there has to be, it's like ping pong. It's going back and forth. God offers forgiveness. He crushes his son. We ask for forgiveness. Now we can go scot-free. But somebody took it on the chin for us. That's Jesus. In those moments when they do something wrong, they break a rule, but there's no punishment. You're the one that's kind of taking it on the chin. You are absorbing that punishment. Outside of that, there has to be some form of reconciliation. This is how forgiveness works. And again, it's such a longer session, but you need to begin to walk in forgiveness. For me in our house, a couple things we've done to walk in forgiveness is, number one, is we very quickly say we're sorry. As a parent, I very quickly say we're sorry. And then when a rule is broken, we walk through. together. How should we deal with this? How should we deal with this? No punishment, a grounding, a spanking, depending on the ages. I'm not spanking my, 19-year-old daughter, but forgiveness. Now, in all of this, we're going to close with this. In all of this, if there's one thing that I could try and finish this off with, in all of this tree, it's not that you're going to be perfect in all of it, because you're not. However, what you should be is just be consistent.
Good word.
Consistency. I'm going to get in God's word. I'm going to give them my trust. I'm going to spend time, set boundaries, and try my best to walk in forgiveness today, and then tomorrow I'm going to read God's word, give them trust, spend time, set boundaries, walk in forgiveness. Tomorrow, read God's word, and you never change. Your children, just real quick, your children's life is so up and down, topsy-turvy, in and out, roller coaster. There's nothing in their world that's solid. Nothing. That's where you and I come in as parents. They need a rock to stand on. Well, I thought Jesus is the rock. Jesus is the rock, but how do they see Jesus? They see him through us. If my son Logan was here, he's given me permission to tell this. Logan, preacher's kid, hit 16 years old, starts to go through some wondering in his mind. Why do I believe what I believe? Do I believe it because I believe it? Because that's what my dad's always told me. Why do we do this? Why do we do that? If our religion's right and their religion thinks they're right, how do we know both are right? And he really begins to question. Then at about 18, he goes to South Carolina and he starts interning at a church. He does that. And then he kind of falls away, pretty harshly falls away from God. And then he comes back at 21, just radically saved on his, just radically, an Apostle Paul type of a moment. Comes back to Christ, whole heart. And I remember the moment he came and he sat down with Veronica and I, and he put his arm around us. He said, "Dad and Mom, I want to tell you thank you." I said, "Why?" "I want to thank you for just being consistent." He said, "Because Dad, I was so mad at you half the time. Because I didn't know why you believed what you believed, but Dad, I had no doubt what you believed. I didn't know that I believed it, but I know that's what my dad believes. And whenever I was thinking this and thinking that, and I didn't even know what to think, I knew, Mom, I know what you think. I know that God's number one. We're going to church. God's going to heal you. Jesus is the way, and you've never moved. And I just want to thank you for being consistent." If there's one thing I could tell you in all of this, is get in God's word, trust, time, boundaries, forgiveness, over and over. When you mess up, start back again. And what I found in my life, I know it's very formulaic, but it's true. Get rooted in Christ, give your trust, spend your time, set good boundaries, walk in forgiveness, and you'll have the fruit in your family that you need. Lord, thank you for today. Bless us. Take this very simple message today and take it deeper into us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for your time.